My name is Marion Koopmans. I'm from the Erasmus Medical Center in Rotterdam. And I'm here in my capacity as chair of the lab technical working group of an initiative to eliminate yellow fever epidemics. And what that is will become clear for those of you that are not aware of it during this session. So why yellow fever? Oh, no disclosures here, so that's clear. So why yellow fever? Well, that's obvious. You live here in a region that is enzootic for yellow fever, and in all we have around 1 billion people in the world that live in regions where yellow fever is present in a wildlife reservoir, and that's a clearly a public health threat. Now, the good news, of course, is that there are working control measures for yellow fever, both at the level of vector control programs and vaccines that work well. And here's an example that illustrates success in looking at numbers of reported outbreaks in Gavi-eligible countries in West Africa, where you clearly see the number of reported outbreaks going down, with no outbreaks for the past 4 years in those countries. But of course, the key message is not to be complacent, because the Silvetic reservoir remains. Elimination, true elimination of yellow fever is unlikely to be possible given that Silvetic cycle. And this is a recent case of a tourist that, because of the lack of outbreaks, felt vaccination was just not necessary, and he contracted fulminant yellow fever infection. So you are all aware of this problem, that we have this Silvetic cycle, but every now and then, and that's where the public health threat is, we see transitions to an urban cycle, transmission cycle, where people take over the role as a reservoir. And you see mosquito-person-mosquito transmission, and that's when you really get the big outbreaks. And that's where we see the biggest public health threat. And of course, when does that happen? When conditions converge that facilitate that, which includes high-density populations, mosquito breeding conditions that are optimal, failing vector control and insufficient population immunity and also vaccine coverage. So those are also pointers at the clear solutions for that. So this is an overview from the state of vaccine coverage published by Shearer and others, which shows that there is room for improvement. So the darkest red, purple, are regions where coverage is close to 100%, but there, as we can see, there is considerable lower coverage in many of the regions, and that has in part to do with budgets, competing priorities, and also vaccine shortage. Now, what the consequences can be, you all are very familiar with the outbreak that we've seen in Ebola spilling over to DRC, which required a massive vaccination campaign to bring that under control. So in the course of that outbreak, 30 million people were vaccinated. That immediately depleted the global vaccine repository at that time, and therefore there was a need to experiment essentially with fractional dosing, which fortunately worked well. But a downstream effect was also that, because of that disruptive outbreak, the routine vaccination programs were disrupted. So for over a year, as you can see, so that routine vaccination resumed in 2018. And then a third observation, which is increasingly being seen, is the exportation of cases, and in this case particularly also to China. And that is related to a quite rapid increase in the amount of exchange of people between China and yellow fever endemic regions, both for tourism, but particularly also for work. And there is this outstanding enigma of what is going on with the risk of yellow fever in Asia. So far, the thinking, so yellow fever has not been detected in Asia, and it's not clear if that is because there is some type of unknown barrier or if it's just a matter of luck. And this modeling paper looked at if we assume that there is potential for establishment and potential for urban cycle yellow fever outbreaks, then they project that there's a very wide geographic region where that could become a problem, and it's obvious that that would really challenge our global capacity to respond to yellow fever. So that brings in the... So that's really the reason why WHO launched this yellow fever epidemic elimination initiative, which is an action plan to increase our level of preparedness and to reduce the impact of yellow fever outbreaks. Started in 2016, and is the first so many year plan, which leans on three components, which are pretty obvious. One is, of course, to protect the populations at highest risk through vaccination. Second is to take a closer look at this prevention of international spread and maybe have risk-targeted campaigns for that, thinking, for instance, about the quite extensive concern of the China travel. And the third is to contain outbreaks rapidly by building on surveillance and particularly also early detection capacity. Now, there's a key problem there, which is at the level of the diagnostics, in that yellow fever, of course, does not stand alone. Yellow fever is part of a complex of viruses that may or may not co-circulate in different forms in different regions, and there is quite extensive cross-reactivity between the key serological assays that are being used for the yellow fever program, and that's a problem. That requires then confirmation with more complex assays, and that's very much in limited availability. So the aim of this particular workshop is to look at some of the country experiences by colleagues present here, review or present work that has been done to review the current capacity for these first-line and confirmatory diagnostics and some of the challenges there, introduce a new initiative launched by Gavi that is targeting this diagnostic gap, and discuss the way I hear from you how you see this should move forward.